if our families have any hope, people must know Jesus. This is what we must experience. The time is coming on this earth where you will have to stand. Days of our probation are fast closing. The end is near. To us the warning is given. Take heed to yourselves. Our Heavenly Father, we come before you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. And we're so thankful that you have brought us back to another evening where we can learn from your holy scriptures. We pray and ask for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, because we recognize that unless your Holy Spirit does battle for us, our minds are incapable of receiving the things that you have in mind for us. We cannot understand them, Lord, without your help. I pray that you would forgive us for our sins, those that we have presumptuously committed. Please have mercy on us. We pray that you would allow us not only to hear your words, but we ask for the mind of Christ so that we would immediately obey. We want desperately to be pleasing in your sight. Help us tonight. Breathe upon us your spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This week, along with next week, we have been talking about dedicating these evenings to the gospel of health. And I don't know if you received your invitation yet, but you want to make sure you get one of these brochures on your way out so that you can invite a friend to come. We have some very exciting talks on health that are going to benefit you personally. One of the things that the enemy wants to do is to cause us to believe that it doesn't matter how we live on earth, that certain diseases are inevitable. Well, we may become sick, that is true. And even though we recognize that sickness comes directly from rebellion and sin, we can completely surrender to Christ. We can completely abide by all of his health principles, and we still can get sick. But the Bible still tells us and gives the promise, the general promise, that if we abide and live a certain way, that our bodies have been designed to fight out certain ailments and certain sicknesses. Now, some people say, what do you mean if we live exactly the way God says we should live, we can die of a sickness? Elisha, the great prophet, died of a sickness, and he healed many people, but he didn't die with a lack of faith in the Lord. You never found him in a cave questioning where was God, because he recognized to die here did not mean to end his life forever. Amen? As a matter of fact, turn with me in a moment to the book of Exodus chapter 15 in your Bibles. The children of Israel had just come across the Red Sea. They had just witnessed Pharaoh and his armies drowned and overcome. And they were just singing a victory song. They were excited about what God had done for them. And God begins by giving them specific instruction that is applicable to us today. The Bible says in Exodus 15, beginning with verse 26, Father, we pray again for a special blessing upon your word. We need an understanding tonight. Thank you in Jesus' name, amen. In verse 26, the Bible says very clearly, and said, if thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and will do that which is right in his sight, and will give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon thee, which I have brought upon the Egyptians. For I am the Lord that what? Healeth thee. In other words, God saying, if we would obey his commandments and we would obey his statutes, he says, I will not allow the sicknesses that come upon the world today to come upon you. And then he says, I am the Lord that heals you. In other words, even if you've been disobedient, even if you have not cooperated with the principles of God, God says, even then I can still heal you if you turn to me. The Bible shows us clearly in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 28 what some of these diseases are. Deuteronomy 28, God shows us what some of the diseases of Egypt are or were. And we find that these same diseases are affecting mankind today. Deuteronomy 28, beginning with verse 27. The Bible says in Deuteronomy 28, beginning with verse 27, if you're there, let me hear you say amen, just so I know you're with me. Amen. The Bible says, the Lord will not smite thee with the botch of Egypt, and with the emrods, and with the scab, and with the itch whereof thou canst not be healed. The Lord shall smite thee with madness and blindness and astonishment of heart. Now when we back up and look at these a little closer, we find that this botch is what we would call cancer today. Emrods is a circulatory disease. Many people are affected by their circulation in their body because of poor dietary habits or the way they treat their bodies. Then it says astonishment of heart. What would that be today? That would be considered heart attack. Many people have clogged arteries. Many people have heart trouble and a direct connection with how they take care of their bodies. And some people say, well, does that apply to us today? Well, the Bible says in the book of 3 John, turn back by the book of Revelation to the book of 3 John and notice what God says here in 3 John. God gives a promise. He says, listen, if you would obey me, if you would obey my principles, if you would follow my commandments, I will allow you to be different from the world. I would allow you to be afflicted with health and not disease. God says here in 3 John, beginning with verse 2, 3 John, beginning with verse 2, the Bible says, beloved, I wish above all things that what? Thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. God says above everything else, he desires prosperity for his people. Now, it's interesting when I listen to a lot of these prominent evangelists and television ministers, the prosperity that they associate as prosperity is prosperity that money can buy. The prosperity here, God is speaking of what money cannot buy. God is saying, I wish above all things that you have health. That means wholeness, not good health. The word health denotes that your health is fine. Poor health means you are not whole. And God says it's a great desire. It burdens the Lord to look upon his people and see them suffering in pain and agony, especially when they can do something about it so that it will be changed. And so we have decided that it is good for all of us if we back up and we start taking time to go through the scriptures night after night. And tonight we'll lay a little foundation, but brothers and sisters, you come out each night, you're going to find things that are so simple that you can do in adjusting your lifestyle that are going to bring immediate health benefits to you. Why is it that we should be concerned? We found the other night that we're not our own. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, we find that we don't belong to ourselves. And even though the Bible clearly tells us who we belong to, we can choose to refuse to be a part of our Maker. Notice what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Heavenly Father, we pray for more of your Holy Spirit. We pray that you would please give us clarity of thought, deep principles, that we would desire to follow thee always. In Jesus' name, amen. The Bible says very clearly in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, beginning with verse 19, what? Know ye not that your body is the temple of what? Of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own. For ye are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God. So God says, you're bought with a price. And what was that price? It was Jesus Christ. It was his blood. We've been talking about the sacrifice that has been made for us. Remember, brothers and sisters, Adam was created perfect. Adam sinned. Before Adam sinned, Jesus, God the Son, decided that he would pay the penalty if man should sin. That penalty had a high price on it. It was not the human nature of Christ that made the deal. God, the second person of the Godhead, was willing to be subjected to the powers and authority of Satan forever. If God the Son, in his humanity, without the assistance of his personal divinity, completely surrendering to his Father, if he could not have done what God is asking us to do, brothers and sisters, not only would we have been eternally lost, but God the Son would have subjected himself to the enemy. But he had confidence that man could be restored. And he paid with his blood. He paid with his life. And it wasn't just a quick death. It wasn't one of these death sentences that you get if you get the death penalty here in the United States, where they lay you down after feeding you the best meal you want to eat and put you on the bed and give you a little drop where you feel no pain and instantly you fall asleep. No, he suffered a bitter death. Blow after blow affected his body, an excruciating pain. And yet, we are told that it wasn't the pain that hurt him the most. It was the sin, the weight of sin. It was the rejection. It was looking at humanity who he had come to die for in a state that appeared that they would not accept his sacrifice. And so God here says, listen, I paid for you. I didn't pay with the gold that I could have spake into existence. I didn't pay with rubies. I paid with my blood. So as a result, we're living in a day and hour where I want your body to be the temple of the Holy Ghost. As a matter of fact, chapter 3 puts it this way of 1 Corinthians. He's speaking to the Corinthians, but tonight he's speaking to us. God expects us to render unto him bodies that are as healthy as possible so that he can cause us to prosper. Notice what it says here in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. It's a serious exhortation in verse 16. The Bible says, know ye not? And it's interesting how Paul started in chapter 6, verse 16 by saying, what? Almost like, are you surprised? You mean you don't know? What? Know ye not? Well, here he says it again. He says, know ye not that the Spirit of God dwelleth where? In you. If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy, for the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are. So that eliminates the whole concept of choice. In other words, it is not optional. You can choose still. But God says, listen, I expect you to live a certain way because you house my spirit. And you remember, brothers and sisters, very clearly, in Daniel chapter 1, in verse 8, Daniel said he purposed in his heart not to defile himself with the king's meat. So when God speaks of defilement, he's speaking of what we put into our bodies. He's speaking of how we take care of ourselves. As a matter of fact, chapter 10 of 1 Corinthians gives us these instructions. Turn to chapter 10 with me a moment. God says, we're the temple of the Holy Ghost. The Lord says, if you would obey me, and if you would keep my commandments and obey my statutes, none of these diseases that are affecting the world will affect you. I can keep you out of harm's way. And notice what the Bible says here in verse 31 of 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Verse 31 of 1 Corinthians chapter 10, the Bible says, whether therefore ye eat, or whatever you eat, or drink, or whatsoever you do, do all to what? The glory of God, or do all to glorify God. Everything we eat and drink, we should be able to place before God, and when we pray over it, we should know that we receive God's blessing over it because it's something that is going to be healthful to our bodies. Now, God is the creator of man. It's the only aspect of, or we are the only aspect of his creation that he became intimately involved in. Remember, let there be light. Divide the firmament. Let there be grass. He spoke everything else in existence. But when it came to us, God got down on his knees, as it were, and took his hands and formed man out of the dust of the ground. And he didn't just draw a little body with a little line where there was a man. He formed the complete and entire human in that dust. If you would have looked at it, it looked like a sculpture. It had a nose. He had a nose. This is why God was able to lean down and breathe into his nostrils. It was all there. He took his time, became intimately involved, and then breathed into the nostrils of man the breath of life, and man became a living soul. When God created man, he had already created the proper diet for man. He created a perfect diet for man, one that would keep man strong, keep him energetic, and even at that time, there was no sin, but God was still concerned with the way man ate. Notice what it says here in verse 29 of Genesis chapter 1. Now, there's no sin involved. Man had not fallen. Man could not get sick. Man could not die because sickness and death are all a result of sin. But even prior to sin, God gave man a diet. God gave man a diet prior to sin. And notice what that diet was. The Bible says in verse 29 of Genesis chapter 1, and God said, behold, I have given you every herb-bearing seed which is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree in the which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed. To you it shall be what? For meat. Now, when it said meat, it meant for food. God says, I've given you all the fruit on the trees. I've given you the seeds. I've given you a perfect diet. Now, some people say, it doesn't matter what you eat. Now, brothers and sisters, you need to understand something. That is the very oldest deception on earth. It doesn't matter what you eat. Because we see very clearly in Genesis chapter 3 that Satan told Eve it didn't matter what she ate. Eve, go on, you can eat whatever you want to eat. Not knowing that a poor diet would cause poor blood, and poor blood to the brain would cause poor judgment. And how poor would the judgment become? It would become so denigrated that man would want to see, desire to see, in self-preservation, the death of his own creator. For when you look at Genesis 3 with me a moment, notice what it says here, brothers and sisters. In Genesis chapter 3, the Bible is very clear. The Bible says in verse 1, now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, have God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? Go on, Eve, eat what you want. And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said unto the woman, you won't really die. Now, brothers and sisters, Adam lived to be 930 years old. You can find that in Genesis chapter 5, verse 5. It says he lived to be 930 years old, and then he died. Eve was lied to. Eve was deceived. She ended up biting and eating that fruit, believing that it didn't matter what she ate. And because she didn't just drop instantly, she took it straight to her husband. She was the one that mobilized sin. Sin was stuck to one place. And now she gives sin a ride to her husband. Now her husband eats it. Now God comes to talk to them, and notice the dialogue, brothers and sisters. Notice what takes place in Genesis chapter 3, verse 9. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? And Adam said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, talking about God, God said unto Adam, who told thee that thou wast naked? Who told you? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat? Now he didn't answer the question. Notice what he said. And the man said, the woman whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree and did eat. God asked him specifically, did you eat from the tree? He turned and said, well, the woman you gave me, she gave it to me to eat. Then he asked the woman, did you eat from the tree? She turned and said, the serpent. They didn't answer the question. Why? They were both trying to evade death. They both knew clearly. The minute God said to Adam, did you eat from the tree that I told you not to? The scripture in chapter 2, verse 17 came to his mind. Notice chapter 2, verse 17. O God of heaven, we plead for your spirit. We beg you for an understanding. Help us, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Listen to what it says. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, what happens? Thou shalt surely die. So when God said to Adam, Adam, did you eat from that tree that I told you not to eat from? God didn't have to finish the sentence. Adam's mind said, uh-oh, I'm going to die. So he didn't answer the question. He pointed to the woman. In other words, he was saying, Lord, you gave me the woman. She caused me to eat. If you had not given me the woman, I would not have eaten the fruit, so you should die. And Eve had the same concept. You put the serpent in the earth. You allowed the serpent to be in the tree. If it wasn't for the serpent, I wouldn't have heard the musical voice. I would not have been lured in. So in other words, because you created the serpent, you should die. Man's desire to be with God after sin was totally gone. Man wanted one thing. Self-preservation. Jesus had already planned to die, praise God. He ran way ahead of the thoughts of the mind that is captured by the delusive powers of Satan. He had already planned to do it. I will die. And so then God altered man's diet at that point. God put man out of the garden, but prior to putting him out of the garden, he added vegetables to his diet. It was first just a fruitarian diet. But after sin, God added the herbs of the field, which we know to be vegetables today. God added a blood-purifying source so that man's body could be strengthened long enough to continue to go on and hear the Spirit of God and follow the Spirit of God by its promptings. God never introduced flesh into the diet until after sin. In other words, God first gave a fruitarian diet. Then after sin, God adds in verse 18, notice what it says in verse 18 of Genesis chapter 3. The Bible says in verse 18 of Genesis chapter 3, thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. That was that green herb. That was that herb that would purify the blood. Then man had a pure diet, as pure as possible even then. It was only after the flood that God introduced what we call now a carnivorous diet, the flesh foods. When the earth was destroyed by the flood, when God allowed this earth to be destroyed because of the sinfulness of man, all the vegetation had been destroyed. All the fruit had been wiped out off the trees. All the grain had been wiped out. So God allowed man to eat flesh food, but it was always supposed to be a temporary diet. God never intended us to have bodies that would be called walking graveyards, where we would house the death of animals. Notice what it says in Genesis chapter 9. Again, brothers and sisters, we have to ask ourselves, can we trust the diet that God prescribed for man? Or can we trust what man tells us to eat today? And that night after night, as you come to these health meetings, you're going to see some incredible things from the scripture. And I promise you that when you pray and you obey God, I promise you that many of you are going to hear this, and you're going to testify to this, because it happens over and over and over again. My doctor told me to throw my medicine away. Now, I'm not telling you to go home and throw your medicine away, but I am telling you that as you come out night after night and you listen to these messages from the Word of God that assist you in better health and better living, your body is going to start literally functioning so much better that your body is not going to demand these man-made scientific medications to assist it, which are in essence just keeping you alive on borrowed time anyway. Medication never heals. You should be living in such a state where you should try your best to avoid every medical doctor you can. Amen. Listen, medical doctors don't teach you nutrition, brothers and sisters. Medical doctors are only, they're only required to take one course in nutrition. Can you imagine? That's why they have nutritionists on their staff. Can you imagine going through medical school without learning what God taught was best for the Bible? And now scientific proof and evidence is coming back and telling you we need to eat more vegetables. We need more grain in our diet. We need more fiber in our diet. And they're telling you this, but because of the meat and dairy industry, they spend billions of dollars making sure that people believe that they need to eat meat for protein, when protein comes from all types of vegetable life. And you've never heard of anyone being protein deficient, or if you have, it is very, very rare. The average American gets too much protein. We're not protein deficient. We have too much. But doctors, they tell you what they've learned. And what they've learned, brothers and sisters, what they've learned is a scientific way to keep you alive regardless of how you live. And that's bad business. Do you know, when I first started teaching this, that 350,000 people would die a year in American hospitals by accidents and mistakes by medical doctors? Now, I'm not against medical doctors, don't get me wrong. Now, I haven't been to one in years. Amen. And I pray to God that I stay healthy enough where I never have to go. I mean, if the crisis comes and I have to go, I'll go. But I do everything in my power to do what I need to do so I don't have to go to a doctor. Because these doctors, they go to and they get all this education. And after they finish, they're given a degree. And on their degree, it says, you can now practice. That's what they tell you. So I believe in practice. When I used to be into sports, I used to practice. I love people who practice. But I try to stay away from people who are practicing, especially with my health. If it's my health, I don't want you practicing on me. I want you to know what you're doing. Amen. Did you know that 350,000 people by doctors' mistakes? That's when I first started teaching this. This was 15 years ago. It's up to 800,000 now. 800,000. You go into the hospital and your toe is hurting And next thing you know, they're explaining to your parents why you died. I know a minister friend. He took his 16-year-old daughter to the hospital. She couldn't break that fever. So he took her to the hospital. They gave her some medication. They said, look, go on, pick her up in the morning. We'll just watch her, but she'll be fine. In the morning, she was dead. On this brochure, it says, fact, nearly half the U.S. adults that receive a flu shot still get the flu. Listen, you know what? I'm not trying to laugh about this. Heavenly Father, I know that sometimes laughter is a natural result of conviction. But tonight, many of my brothers and sisters who you died for, many humans are suffering because they don't know, because they have not been exposed to the truth as it is in your word. I pray that your Holy Spirit would convict our hearts so that we will become living testimonies, so that we will be willing not only to be at these meetings and learn, but to bring others, so that we can be a part of facilitating minds and health so that your Holy Spirit can speak to them. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Listen, this is serious. I watched my mother, and I loved my mother. I watched my mother have to take all these different bottles of medication. She was exposed to this same message that I'm teaching tonight. She was always in pain. I remember asking my mother the question. I said, Mom, is it really painful? She said, it's life. She said, I'm in pain so often, if I don't feel pain, that's what's unnatural. And here God said, above all things, I want you to prosper and be in health. I'll never forget being at a restaurant, and they were putting the food on the table when I got the call that my mother dropped dead. That's it, just dropped. I was so thankful that my mother did not have to suffer anymore. She lived an excruciating, suffering life. From her childhood, the bitter things she experienced as a child, being molested from 4 years old all the way up until she was 15 by a stepfather, had her fingers burnt off because she said she was going to tell. And from that point, psychologically, she never, ever was able to get a grip. And she always had health problems. And I believe it was a direct result of stress, which I know is a direct result of a lack of understanding of faith, a lack of understanding of how to cast your cares upon Christ. Brothers and sisters, last time I took a stress test and some other, I didn't have any of it. They said, I can't believe you travel and do what you do. Why don't you? Because I cast my cares upon Jesus. I do not go to bed worried at night. I don't have any grudges. I don't hate anybody. I have forgiven anyone that has done anything to me. I agonize and plead and pray and beg God to help those who think they're my enemies. God wants us to have health, brothers and sisters. I've seen many people go to graves that are absolutely causeless. And some people say, well, wait a minute, you know, it was their time. Ecclesiastes chapter 7 is very clear. Turn with me there a moment, brothers and sisters. God wants us to have health. Hospitals are getting larger and larger. They're renovating. They're getting more and more advanced in technology. Yet more and more people are dying in them. Doctors are desensitized to the power of God. You know, I'll never forget when my sister had leukemia. And by the way, you'll find that the number one cancer that is found in children is leukemia. Why do you think leukemia is the number one cancer found in children? Because they find this cancerous disease in cattle, in cow's milk. God never designed us to drink cow's milk. A cow won't drink your milk. Find a pregnant woman. Find a pregnant woman and go to a La Leche group and get a pump and pump some milk and take it to a cow, a thirsty cow. The cow will not drink your human milk. What makes you think that when your baby stops nursing from you or getting your milk, it needs the milk of an animal? It's unnatural. It's absolutely ludicrous, if you think about it, brothers and sisters. But what has happened is the money, again, the money that the industry, the dairy industry gets, they say everybody needs milk. That's one of the biggest lies that has ever been told. The milk from a cow will deplete your body from calcium. It won't add calcium to your body. So, again, if we don't understand these truths from God's word, and this is not just something I'm throwing out here. Night after night, when you come, they're going to show you scientific facts that you do not need it. Also, over 87% of all the milk that is sold in America has blood and pus in it, because they put them on these pumps and they start pumping the cows. Now, you have 2,000-3,000 heads of cows being pumped. Well, the machine cannot detect when the cow is empty. And so when one cow empties, the pumps are still going. They're on timers. And when the timer stops, that's when the machine stops. So it tears the tissue and it tears the ligaments. And now all of a sudden what happens? Blood is being pumped into the milk. Well, they don't pull the cow that has been injured aside and say, hey, let's nurse this cow and let's help him. No, they shoot it up with antibiotics and they put that cow right back on that pump. Well, inflammation settles in, pus, a form of trying to heal the body naturally, and now they pump again. And where does it go? Into your milk. Now, I don't drink milk, but when I used to drink milk, I used to like it cold. And I would put it in the freezer where the glass would get nice and frosty, and I'd get me a nice cookie or a donut and dip it in and just let it just not where to fall down into the bottom of the glass, you know, just right to where, and then you take it and you bite it, and an Oreo cookie. Boy, I can just taste it now. That Oreo cookie, that chocolate with that sugar and that blood and pus would just say, ooh. Yeah, that dairy industry is not interested in your health. They're not interested in your health at all. And that's why, brothers and sisters, in the beginning, God did not ask us, or he did not prescribe that we drink from a cow. Have you ever driven down the street on a back road and seen cattle on a hill? Have you ever pictured them and you're driving and the cattle are just all up on the hill and you look at the cow? As you're driving, let me ask you a question. As you're driving, did you ever look and say, man, I sure would like to pull over and bite one of those cows? Now, I got one person shaking his head, and he's just kidding. He's a preacher that jokes a lot. Have you ever driven down the street and seen an orchard with fruit on it? And as you're driving, look and saying, wow, I sure would like to pick one of those peaches. Yes, it's natural. When you look at a cow long enough, you know you're not supposed to eat it. Flies bouncing off of it, the face. Our minds, it was a temporary diet after the flood. Now, the Bible says here in verse 17 of Ecclesiastes chapter 7, notice what it says in verse 17 of Ecclesiastes chapter 7. It says, be not over much wicked, neither be thou foolish. Why shouldest thou die before thy time? So the Bible says that we could die before it is intended, the time is intended for us to die, by doing things that are foolish. Did you know that there's a book out called Overcoming the Food Seductions? And it's by a number one medical, a leading medical doctor who is into natural diets. He shows in the book that meat eating will cause you to crave cocaine, and it will have the same effects on the body as cocaine. Have you ever wondered why it is that people can't shake some of these habits of drugs? It shows very clearly that they have found in cheese. They say that cheese, they found morphine in cheese. So they thought that the morphine in the cheese came from the cow's diet. So they took some cows and they put them on and raised them on a completely natural diet without shooting them with any medication, raised what they call organic cattle. And then they tested the meat, and they found later that the cow produces morphine in its body. Now, the morphine comes out in the cheese in low doses, so it won't cause you to wreck while you're driving, but it will cause you to crave more. And this is why people say, give me extra cheese, or give me double cheese, or people just like to buy cheese and just eat cheese, because it's stimulating a part of your brain, and it is causing the exact effect that someone gets when they hit that crack pipe. The prophet of the Lord. This prophet I've been talking about every night. Matter of fact, I gave you some of her statements I'm going to let you read tonight when you go home. Every night I've been giving you statements from this prophet. This prophet had a third grade education. It's fascinating that with a third grade education, God showed her very clearly, said cheese is unfit for food. And then she said that cheese should never be introduced to the body. Now, over 100 years ago, you have a prophetess given this instruction, and now this, in our day, we find where scientists and medical doctors are now telling you the same thing. I tell you, God has a prescribed diet. And even when God said in Exodus chapter 9 that man could eat certain types of meat, or when he said that the animal kingdom would be food for him, God specified certain types of meat to be eaten. God never gave us carte blanche. He never just said, eat anything you want to eat. Notice what it says in Leviticus chapter 11. And I'm going to give you a few more texts and then I'll let you go home. But notice in Leviticus chapter 11. And by the way, brothers and sisters, this is not optional what I'm talking about tonight. God said the body's the temple of the Holy Spirit. God says we take on the nature of what we eat. And I'm going to show you that in a few minutes. Notice in Leviticus 11, God had given specific instruction on what types of meat should be eaten. In Leviticus 11, beginning with verse 2, the Bible said, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, these are the beasts which ye shall eat among all the beasts that are on the earth. And then God goes on to tell you what the beasts are like that you can eat. And then he tells you what you should not eat. In verse 4, nevertheless, these shall ye not eat, of them that chew the cud, or of them that divide the hoof, as the camel, because he cheweth the cud, but divideth not the hoof. He is unclean unto you. And the coney, because he cheweth the cud, but divideth not the hoof. He is unclean unto you. And the hare, because he cheweth the cud, but divideth not the hoof. He is unclean unto you. And the swine, though he divide the hoof, and be cloven-footed, yet he cheweth not the cud. He is unclean unto you. Of their flesh ye shall not eat, and their carcass shall ye not touch. They are unclean unto you. The swine is what we call the pig. That's the most popular today. God did not create the pig for you to eat. Now, how do you think God looks on earth? And he sees the created being that he created to be superior to all things. Then he sees the created being that he created to clean up the earth. A pig will eat anything. His whole job was to keep the earth clean. And so he says to you, it's unclean. I don't want you to eat what that pig will eat. Lady looking out her window washing dishes, all of a sudden she sees the neighbor's dog run up. And she bangs on the window because that dog's sitting out there getting ready to use a bathroom in the yard. She, get. And the dog looks up and runs, but it's too late. Lady doesn't go and clean it up right away, and all of a sudden flies start coming on top of it. Just big pile right in her yard. Then she looks up and sees a frog come and eat a couple of flies. And she sees something weird. A snake came out the bushes and ate the frog. And then the snake went down into her pig pen, and the pig ate the snake. And then you ate the pig. Now you should have started your meal right out in her front yard. Have mercy. God's intention for us, brothers and sisters, is not to eat a big old poisonous pig. He goes on to talk about the different types of birds you should and should not eat. The different fish. Shrimp. You ever see it? All you can eat. Now, what is a shrimp full of? Then what are you full of when you eat a shrimp? I mean, this shrimp is full of trash and garbage from the sea. And we're sitting there saying, you know, I love that this shrimp is so tasty. Man has created different seasonings to allow you to enjoy eating fecal matter. Okay, for the children, that's called poo-poo. Have mercy. And it's a reality. Do you think God intends for us to get our food like this? No, brothers and sisters. The Lord says, above all things, I want you to prosper and be in health. I want you to be well. I want you to be whole. I don't want you to be... Why do you think it is that our bones are in such pain? Why do you think it is our circulation is now stopping? Why do you think it is that diabetes is starting to control mankind and mankind not control it? It's because we are putting into our body that which God never designed. And even when he said we could eat meat, he told us that there were certain ways that we were to eat the meat. He said that we were never to eat the meat with blood in it. Leviticus 17. Notice what the Bible says. Leviticus 17. We were never supposed to eat meat with blood in it. God loves us. Now, some people sit and they think, well, you know what? Religion is too restrictive. Brothers and sisters, let me tell you something. Religion is not restrictive. God loves you. God has given us health principles for one purpose, to alleviate the sufferings of people. That's why he gave it to us, to alleviate suffering. He knows, just like if you take your car and you put sugar, refined white sugar, into your gas tank, you know what's going to happen? It's going to tear up your engine. It's going to destroy it. That same refined white sugar, when you put it into your body, destroys and tears up your body. But you will appreciate and you will appreciate and you will care for your car more than you will your body. The manufacturer tells you, you must put premium gas in this car. Well, some people, oh, it doesn't make a difference, and they put regular in it. Well, for a while, that car will run off regular. But after a while, guess what? It will break down. And your warranty will not be honored because they will find that you did not put the proper gas that they told you to put in it. They even put a little sign on the gas tank in case you forgot. Remember, only premium gas. But you say, no, that costs 10 cents more. The manufacturer knows what will keep his product running. God knows, even after sin, what will keep us running the longest. And again, it's with the clearest minds. The war is over the mind. Satan wants to control your mind. And he can manipulate and he can use your emotion and everything else. But God speaks directly to the mind of man because he's always longed for that type of relationship with man. Never does God use tactics of rape. In other words, bypassing your reasoning and your ability to make a choice. He always wants you to make a clear choice. The devil will rape you. He will force himself upon you. He will slip his thoughts into your subconscious mind and feed you until before you know it, you are killing yourself and you don't remember or know where the seed came from. God desires desperately for us to be happy, healthy, even though you have to die. You can be like Moses. Moses, when he died at 120 years old, Moses died with keen eyesight, with health and vigor of a teenager. He was strong. He laid down, went to sleep, and never woke up until, of course, Christ resurrected him. That's the way God would like all of us to die. Unfortunately, some of us won't. But even if we die of a disease, we will never die the way the world dies if we cooperate with the principles of God's health. Why? Because we have God's promise we can put to him. And his promise said, none of these diseases will come upon you. His promise is always, can always not only be trusted, but brothers and sisters, God comes through for it because he cannot lie. That's just God. And I praise God, that's the type of God we serve. Notice here in Leviticus 17. Leviticus 17, beginning with verse 10, it says, and whatsoever man there be of the house of Israel or of the strangers that sojourn among you that eateth any manner of blood, I will even set my face against that soul that eateth blood and will cut him off from among his people. For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that maketh an atonement for the soul. Therefore, I said unto the children of Israel, no soul of you shall eat blood, neither shall any stranger that sojourneth among you eat blood. And whatsoever man there be of the children of Israel, or of the strangers that sojourn among you, which hunteth and catcheth any beast or fowl that may be eaten. Notice, that may be eaten, because there were certain foods that could not be eaten. That may be eaten, he shall even pour out the blood thereof and cover it with dust. For it is the life of all flesh. The blood of it is for the life thereof. Therefore I said unto the children of Israel, ye shall eat the blood of no manner of flesh, for the life of all flesh is the blood thereof. Whosoever eateth it shall be cut off, or whosoever eats it shall die. God said, you take on those animalistic behavior when you eat that blood. You take on the disease of the animal. God said, no. So first of all, when they were to eat an animal, the animal had to be inspected. The animal couldn't be sick. They didn't rush hundreds of animals to the slaughter the way they do today. Where animals, if they lived one day, if they didn't kill the animal would have died on his own. So they rush him to the slaughterhouse, and they slaughter this animal, and the adrenaline in the animal is running, and the animal's frightened because it hears and senses what's going on ahead of him with the other animals, and they just kill him with pain. God had a certain specific way. First of all, the animal had to be as healthy as possible. If they knew a disease was in the animal, they couldn't kill the animal. What do they do with us? They cut the disease out. They'll kill the animal, and they'll take the cancerous tumors and all the clots and all the bad poisonous parts of the meat, and they throw it in one big grinder, and they grind that meat up, and they make hot dogs and bologna. Amen. That's not a secret. People know it. The worst meat to get. And as a child, I had those weenie roasts. Oh, I used to love eating hot dogs. I had no idea I was eating cancerous tumors and poisoned eyes and the tongue that had been grinded up together in a cow. The devil wants to destroy us, brothers and sisters. God said that that animal, first of all, should have been healthy. Number two, the animal should have been killed without suffering. The blood should have been drained from the animal, and then they would take the meat and they would put it in a salt-like solution and they would drain all the blood. They would take the meat out of that solution and they would hit it with like a tenderizer and put in a fresh batch of solution again until all the blood was out of it. It would be something like a belt today that we would wear. That's what it would be like. And then they would be able to eat it. And God said anyone getting caught eating the blood, he was to die. Because he would start taking on that animal characteristics. And he would start acting and behaving even worse than an animal himself. Man's blood and animal blood was never to mix. An animal's blood cannot help you if you're lacking blood in a hospital. You need the blood of a human. God never intended this to be for us. So brothers and sisters, what we have here is we have a whole world that has denied the promises and principles of God. In that chapter of Exodus 15, when you see God saying, if thou would hearken, diligently hearken unto all my commandments, if you would do what I say. When God says this, God was leading the children of Israel. Now listen, I'm going to close here because they're going to give you a lot more principles. God was leading the children of Israel on an 11 to 21 day journey into the promised land. 11 days took 40 years. All it should have been. Notice what it says in the book of Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 1. Listen, God, when God said these principles, they had crossed the Red Sea. They were on an Egyptian diet. They were eating flesh. They were eating anything they wanted to eat. And God said, I'm going to take you into the promised land. Now today, brothers and sisters, we're not talking about going into the human or earthly Canaan land. We're trying to prepare our minds to go into the heavenly Canaan land. Now here, God gave them this promise. If you do what I ask you to do, hearken diligently. I mean, be careful to follow me in all the precepts and principles that I give you, and I will cause none of these diseases to come upon you. Well, notice what it says here in Deuteronomy chapter 1, beginning with verse 2. The Bible says in verse 2, there are 11 days' journey from Horeb by the way of Mount Seir to Kadesh Barnea. In other words, Kadesh Barnea was right on the other side of the Jordan where they would cross and go into the promised land. 11 days. And they end up taking 40 years. Why? Notice what it says in chapter 2. The Bible says in chapter 2, beginning with verse 15 of Deuteronomy, it says, first it says right here, beginning with verse 1, it says in Deuteronomy, Heavenly Father, as I close, please clear my thoughts. Help me to take my time. In Jesus' name, amen. Notice what it says. Now, first it said 11 days journey. Then it says these three words, then we what? Turned. Why did they turn? Because they didn't listen to the prophet of God. God sent 12 spies. 10 came back at first saying how nice it was, but then they turned and said, it's impossible for us to do what God has called us to do. We cannot take the land. We can't make it in. And 2 said, no, we can do it. We can do it. And they rebelled against God. You can read it right there in Deuteronomy chapter 1. They rebelled against God. And as a result, God said, go back into the wilderness. And the Bible says, then they turned and went back instead of going forward. And the reason why? For 38 years, the hand of God was against them. Why? Because they did not obey God. You know, this teaching that you can live how you want to live, eat what you want to eat, listen to whatever type of music you want to listen to, worship how you want to worship, it's unbiblical. It cannot be substantiated from the Bible. God has always had principles and by which his people are to live by, because he's trying to prepare them to live in the heavenly Canaan. Notice what it says here in verse 15. The Bible says in verse 15 of Deuteronomy chapter 2, for indeed the hand of the Lord was against them to destroy them from among the host until they were consumed. Have mercy. We don't want God to turn on us, but they complained, they bickered, they begged for the food they wanted to eat, they worshiped the way they wanted to worship, and God said, okay, Moses, fine, send them back. As a matter of fact, the Bible says in Jeremiah chapter 7, listen to how they're described. In Jeremiah chapter 7, God had said in the very beginning, listen, I've delivered you, you're going to Jeremiah 7. God said, listen, I've delivered you. I brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. And then he laid out some principles for him. He said, if you would obey my commands, if you do what I ask you to do, none of these diseases. But you know what? All they could do is complain. All they did is went against God and begged to be back in Egypt. And Egypt is a symbol of the world. When we give our hearts to God, our lives are supposed to change. The world has a right to see a difference in us. Our friends, we shouldn't have to tell our friends, I've been born again. They will look at you and say, what's wrong? Something's different. And then you will say, I've been born again. And here the Bible says, describing the experience of these Israelites, in verse 23, it says very clearly, in verse 23, the Bible says, but this thing commanded I them, saying, obey my voice, and I will be your God, and ye shall be my people. And walk ye in all the ways that I have commanded you, that it may be well unto you. But the Bible says what? Read that with me. But they hearkened not, nor inclined their ear, but walked in the counsels and in the imagination of their evil hearts, and went backwards and not forward. They got so caught up in themselves. If that's not the world today, God saying, do this, and no, I'm going to do what I want to do, Lord. They got to the point, brothers and sisters, where they fulfilled the prophecy that Paul told Timothy in Timothy chapter 4.
When Paul told Timothy, preach the word, Timothy, be instant in season and out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with longsuffering and doctrine, for the time is going to come when they will not endure sound doctrine or sound principles, but heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. In other words, they'd find preachers that would teach them what they wanted to hear. If they wanted a certain type of a big party in church, they'd go to a church that party. They want a church that said they could gamble, they'd go to a church that played bingo. This is what they did. And you know what they did? They started choosing their own leaders. That's what Israel did. They didn't want the leader that God had chosen. They start choosing their own leaders. Look at what Nehemiah says. Nehemiah chapter 9. Notice what it said. Nehemiah, what chapter are we going to? Nehemiah chapter 9. You see, brothers and sisters, we are simply repeating the journey in the wilderness. God is trying. God is desperately trying to save us as a people. But you know what? Some of us don't want to be saved. We don't want to be saved. We want to do as we please. And you know one thing I love about God? With tears, He allows us to do it. With a longing of heart to see us change, He will allow us. I mean, He will reorchestrate the plans of our lives over and over and over again until the angel reports all that heaven does is in vain. They will not receive you. The Bible, when it says if you believe on Christ, it's not just saying I believe. We found in the Word of God in the book of James the other night that the devil believes and trembles. He believes in God. So just say, oh, I believe. And I'm, no. If you believe, then you will surrender to Him and you will allow His mind to be in your mind and you will allow His Spirit to guide and dictate to you your steps. Notice what it says here. The Bible says, beginning with verse 16 of Nehemiah 9, the Bible says, but they and our fathers dealt proudly, that means arrogantly, and hardened their necks and hearkened not to the thy commandments. Then notice what it says. And refused to obey, neither were mindful of thy wonders that thou didst amongst them, but they hardened their necks, and in their rebellion they appointed a captain to return to their bondage. Hey, we don't want Moses. And that's what we do too. It's the same thing. We don't pray about who we elect as presidents in some of these conferences. We don't pray about who's going to be the pastor. We look at who's going to move the people, who will draw a lot of people. God is not in a popularity contest. They started choosing who would agree with them. They started choosing people who would satisfy their own carnal desires. They got to the point, and this is where we are as a people, believe it or not, where they didn't want to hear the truth. Isaiah chapter 30 says it this way. Isaiah 30. Let me give you a couple more texts. Isaiah chapter 30. Listen to what the Word of God says. Brothers and sisters, they didn't want to hear truth. They hated truth. They wanted to do what they want to do. You know, it'd be a lot easier. I remember when I first started teaching, I had some ministers tell me, listen, when you teach people about health, don't tell them about vegetarian. Just tell them about the good meats and the bad meats. Don't tell them about white sugar. Don't. Brothers and sisters, these things are destroying more people than anything else. We lock our doors. We put alarms on our homes. You walk out of the store and you look and you see a car that may be following you. You hurry to your car. You get in your car. You lock it. You look in your rearview mirror. You go. You start turning corners. This car looks like it's following you. You speed up a little bit. You get in your driveway. You open your garage, you go in, you close the garage, you get in, you lock everything up. Then you're peeping out so that you'll be safe. Then you open your refrigerator. Have mercy. And you pull something out that is more detrimental than the man in the parking lot. We have to become concerned. We have to become concerned. Why? Because we are called by God not only to house the Spirit of the living God, but to have the authority and power to command unclean spirits so that people can hear the gospel who are trapped. There are people that are trapped right now under the influence of crack cocaine and alcohol under the influence of tobacco, and we want to send them to some scientific rehab center that would teach them psychologically rather than be able to go over them and anoint them with oil and pray and cast the powers of darkness off of them and tell them they are free right now in Christ and teach them how to abide in Christ and the things of God so that they might have victory. I didn't go to a rehab. The Holy Spirit delivered me from crack cocaine. I didn't go to a rehab. The Holy Spirit took the tar and nicotine out of my veins where I would not long for cool filter kings. The Spirit of God is still alive, but he's insulted at our methods and means because the people of God, first of all, lack a real experience, and then they lack a real knowledge of who God is. So we turn to the arm of flesh. And when the truth comes, we want an easy way out. It's an easier way to take blood pressure medication than to drink the right amount of water every day and to get up and walk every day. We are trapped, and the Lord wants to free us. But here we are living in a day and hour where man does not want truth. Man has turned from following God. And it doesn't mean he doesn't pray, because all the years that they wandered in that wilderness, all the time they spent there, they worshiped. They offered sacrifices. They prayed. They saw the cloud by day and the fire by night. They acknowledged that there was a God, but they worshiped the way they wanted to rather than the way God said they needed to. They didn't want the truth. Listen to where it is right now. And some of you can really identify with this. This is a reality. In verse 8, the Bible says in Isaiah 30, in verse 8, Isaiah 30, the Bible says, "Now go write it before them in a table and note it in a book, that it may be for the time to come, forever and ever, that this is a rebellious people, lying children, children that will not hear the law of the Lord, which say to the seers, see not, and to the prophets, prophesy not unto us right things, speak unto us smooth things, prophesy deceits," and especially in that church they call the Remnant Church, "don't tell us the truth." The seer was a prophet like Moses. The seer was a prophet that had special visions. When it said to the other prophets, those were the teachers that taught prophecies. And they told them, don't tell us that. Give us, tickle us. Tell us something that'll make us feel real good. We want heaven without having to give up earth. Tell us how we could fill our bank accounts. Don't tell us what we have to get rid of. Let us watch whatever we want to watch. Even the big ministers are going into the television business now. Have mercy. And this is where we are. And this is the mindset of man. God says he calls these preachers that won't tell the truth. I'll let God say it. Go with me to Jeremiah, brothers and sisters. Isaiah chapter 56. Let me let God say it to you, because you might think I'm saying it. It says in chapter 56 of Isaiah, speaking of preachers who won't preach. And they don't preach, number one, because they don't want to live it. And people go hear them because they can do what they want to do. Isn't it interesting? You see the preacher at the same concert you're at. The preacher smiling and laughing. Why do you think it is that these punk rock and hip-hop and jazz musicians and rock and roll musicians, why do you think when they get awards, they get up and the first person they think is God? Now here you have degraded the women, told women to shake their bottoms and walk around naked and called them all types of whores and other names. And then you get up and say, "I want to first of all praise my God." God had nothing to do with that. Zero. And some of you saying, no, you listen to it. You watch stuff on television that God is not the executive producer, the director, the producer, nor is he an actor. But you watch it. And you enjoy it, and you don't pick your Bible up and open it and read it all. Be not deceived. The Bible says in Romans 6:16, "Know ye not to who you yield yourselves servants to obey? That's whose servant you are, to whom you obey." If you're following the things of earth, you belong to Satan. I don't care how much you cry and call on the name of Jesus. I told you that in 1993, one of my young evangelists went and knocked on a door to give Bible studies, and the lady took the studies the first time. When he went back the second time, she said, "Listen, I want to show you something," and brought him into her home, took him in the back, opened a beautiful treasure chest, pulled out a beautiful Bible, and opened the Bible. It was a Bible for a church of Satan. She was a Satanist. And in that Bible, she said, we believe in Jesus too. Jesus is Satan's number one angel, demon. That's what Satan calls him. The demon closest to him. You can call on Jesus all you want, but who's really going to answer? Who's answering your prayers? Satan can answer prayers. He can help you pay a bill, and you get up and testify. But your life is totally opposite of honest, of pure, of just. And you're not even asking God to help you. You have a rack with all this stuff in it. You are proud to have filth in your home. And so you don't want to hear a preacher telling you about it because you don't want to change. You have itching ears. You want to go where a preacher's going to say, oh, you know, you need a little entertainment. Let me tell you something. It's nothing more entertaining to me than feeling the presence of the Holy Spirit, putting his arms around me saying, I love you, son. Causing my eyes to blurt up with tears and tears ripping down my face saying, you're going to be saved. It's not always going to be like this. Don't worry about it. Keep pressing, son. Get up and press. You're talking about entertaining. Nothing can replace the experience that God will have with you if you give him personal time, day after day, night after night. It'll be so warm. Sometimes you will feel the literal presence of angels. Sometimes you will feel them in your room, your home. You'll have expressions of love. But no, we have trained our minds to be comfortable in the setting with demonic influence. We can sit and laugh at jokes that caused Jesus to hang on the cross. Now, how can you say he's your Savior when certain jokes that will cause you to laugh so hard were the same sins that caused him to hang on that cross? And we say, brothers and sisters, we need a mind change. We need to be converted tonight. Listen to what it says here. Verse 10. See, this is the problem. This is why every night I tell you need to read. Because the Bible says his watchmen are blind. They are all ignorant. They are all dumb dogs that cannot bark, sleeping, lying down, loving slumber. Yea, they are greedy dogs which can never have enough, and they are shepherds that cannot understand. They all look to their own way, every one, for his gain, for his quarter. God said these leaders are dumb dogs. He says not that they won't bark, they can't bark. Especially the church I grew up in. I look at these leaders, they can't bark because they don't know the message anymore. Even if they wanted to bark, they wouldn't know what to say. And I look at other churches, because it doesn't matter what denomination, the devil attacks the leadership, gets them caught up in a popularity contest. And on one hand, you have the people of authority and wealth telling them, look, preach unto us, smooth things, make us laugh, tickle us, come on, Jesus is joy. On the other hand, they don't know the message. They don't know the Bible. They're not reading. They're watching the videos and DVDs you're watching. If we were judged on our Blockbuster record alone, would you be saved? Just if Blockbuster hit the button and printed out all the movies you rented. If the cable station, you think they don't know what you're watching? They have what is called Nielsen ratings, where they know what every household is watching every single minute. You think God's not keeping a record? With terrible exactness, angels are writing everything we do. And we're pushing God to the point where God has to give us up. We're forcing him to do it. We get to the point where you don't ever want to hear these words. You don't ever want to get to the point where you experience this final text I'm going to give you. Jeremiah chapter 14. Listen, let me tell you something, brothers and sisters. This world is about to end. Jesus is making up a number. God is trying to give us light so that we will have an advantage. This is why this is why the Lord has set aside a week of health where we'll learn how to eat, understand nutrition. You would have to pay thousands of dollars for half of this at one of these secular institutions. The Lord says, listen, I want you to be in health so you can prosper. What type of prosperity? He's not talking about this earthly stuff. He'll give you earthly things. It doesn't mean anything. But but he wants you to have eternal life. He wants you to live in the place that he personally prepared for you. He didn't send a maid and say, get the room ready, they're coming. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I will come again. The same way he got involved in creating man in the dust of the ground, he created a place for you in heaven and promised that he's coming again to take you. Why disappoint him and not go? Why disappoint him? You see, God is keeping a record. And the record is to see whether or not you'll be comfortable in heaven. That's what it's all about. God would love for everybody to go. Everybody, come on. Everybody, come out the graves. Come on, everybody, let's just go. But he knows that you would get there and you would be miserable because he's not going to change. He's not going to alter any of his principles to accommodate you. So you would be up there and it's no Jay-Z. It's no Ludacris. No hip-hop up there. No soap operas. No dirty jokes. No beer. No alcohol. Say, oh, but Jesus drank wine. He did not drink fermented wine. Hold your thumb there and turn with me to Matthew 26. Let me show you that right now. And we'll teach more on that. And you brothers and sisters, he did not drink fermented wine. He did not drink alcohol that destroyed the body. Wine, every sip destroys blood cells that can never be replenished. Some people can take one sip and be hooked on it for life. Others can drink it sociably and handle it. Why would God tell you to do such a thing? Destroying blood cells when you need all of your mind. We need all of our power to fight the wicked forces of self. Not the devil. The devil's not your enemy. Christ is Satan's enemy. Satan is Christ's personal enemy. Self is your enemy. You have to fight self. Keep self dead and cooperate with God so that he can get you into the kingdom. Self will have you burn. Self will have you forfeit the mansion that Christ created for you. Notice what it says here in the book of Matthew chapter 26. Matthew 26, beginning with verse 64. No, I'm sorry, it's before that. Hold it, let me find it for you. 29, thank you, Lord. Father, thank you so much. I thank you for coming and being willing to dwell in this room with sinners like me. Tonight we come for heart transformation. Tonight we want victory, Lord. Please accommodate us. Help us to die to self. In Jesus' name we pray. Notice what it says in verse 29. Jesus had been with his disciples. He says, but I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. God said, I won't drink this wine, this fruit of the vine, with you until I get to my Father's kingdom. The wine that destroys your body is fermented. Fermentation is a result of sin. Fruit will not ferment in heaven. Fruit is always going to be good. Brothers and sisters, when we pick a piece of fruit in heaven, you can eat one piece and it's going to be combustionable. In other words, when you bite it, the juices are going to cause your jaws to... You cannot imagine. I have not seen ear heard the things that God has for you and me. Brothers and sisters, when you bite it, after three bites, you look up and here comes one of your friends. They've been traveling all over the other world. And you put it down on your table in your mantle. And you leave with them to go to another world. You come back 1,000 years later, and guess what? It's riper and richer than when you left it. This isn't fiction. It's nonfiction. I want to go there. I'm going to eat some of that fruit. But before I eat that fruit, I'm going to put my arms around Jesus. Lord, there's been a barrier between us because of sin. Whew, I cannot wait to grab my Savior. And then we could eat all the fruit we want, but I have to grab Jesus. You know why? Because he was the only one. I never got a pastor that came and visited me when I left the church. I never had a pastor tell me there was hope. I never had a church member come and say, brother, there's hope. They told me I was no good. Said, don't bring your children around me. But Jesus, he was right there. Right there. Lonely nights. Even when I came back to the church, people who knew my life prior didn't want to be around me. They looked at me with almost short-sighted, questioning, but not Jesus. He said, come on, son, I'll be with you. When I tried my best to do the right thing, the people who had Christ all this time ignored. They didn't want to be bothered. I was a fanatic to them, but you know what? God loved this fanatic. I can't wait to see Jesus. But brothers and sisters, unfortunately, many are going to meet him, but it's not going to be in peace. Because they're at a point in their life where they love the things of this world. And heaven would be miserable. I mean, absolutely miserable, because there'll be no fornicating in heaven. There'll be no adultery in heaven. You don't get, no. So God is trying to get us to surrender tonight so that we can get to the point where we can appreciate a pure and happy environment. But see, some of us, like the children of Israel, we love to wander. You see, they wandered so long or walked away from God so long that they got to the point where they loved it. They love being in a backslidden condition. They love rebelling. And then they heard these fatal words that you don't ever want to hear. Because when God gives you up, he is not fickle-minded like these little relationships that we form here. No. You're together today and you break up and you're back together. No. When God says that's it, that's it. Notice in Jeremiah 14. I'm closing with this. Notice what it says. Jeremiah 14, verse 10. The Bible says, thus saith the Lord unto this people, thus have they what? Loved to wander. They enjoyed it. They have not refrained their feet. Therefore, the Lord doth not accept them. He will now remember their iniquity and visit their sins. In other words, now God will not blot your sins out. When God remembers your sins, the wages of sin is debt. That means now you have to pay the bill. Christ paid it. It's already paid. But in your pride, you reject the payment and say, let me pay it. So God says, okay, you know what? You can pay your own debt. You love to wander. Your feet love to wander. You love to stay where you wanted to. And I have opened up the windows of heaven. And if I had to, I would empty and pour out every single angel to keep you from falling. If you would just get on your knees and pray in a difficult situation. Every single angel. Listen. Every single angel would be poured out to help you if you would stop and pray. Even when you find yourself in the middle, you should say, Lord, look at me. I need help. My flesh has overcome me again. I would hit the crack pipe, and I would say, Lord, look at me hitting this cocaine pipe. I know it's sin. I know it's wrong. Please help me. Lord, I'm going to take you in the crack house with me. Do not let go of your hold on God. You have to pray. You have to fight. You have to agonize. If I knew what I knew tonight, I knew that I could have had instantaneous victory. But I didn't understand righteousness by faith. Faith in his power to deliver me right now. I thought I had to work my way up to being delivered. No. And we have to trust that it'll be okay if we choose God's way. We can't look at the way things are. Faith is what you don't see. Let it alone and trust God to fix it. God said they love to wander. They don't want to change. And brothers and sisters, right now, our high priest, Jesus, right now is praying for us. Tonight, right now, Jesus is not somewhere enjoying the bliss of heaven. He's in the presence of his Father, agonizing for everybody in this room. The priests used to pray for the people as a symbol of Christ praying for us. You get to the point where you will not turn to God, and you continue to hold on to the things of this world. And God says, I will remember their sins. And then finally, this is what happens. In verse 11, then said the Lord unto me, pray not for this people, for their good. Did you hear that? You have an angel that reports in your behalf to the kingdom of heaven. He leaves this earth and he goes to the kingdom. He presents a golden card to get into the gates. Demons can't get in. And he goes directly to the throne. And he reports on your condition to Jesus. That angel has so much that he can do for you before he must be on. He cannot lie. He cannot color it. He cannot make it something that it's not. He tells the truth to his father. He goes and he says, they are joined to their idol. Let them alone. God chases you and follows you with warnings and tender mercy until he sees that any further appeals would only be in vain. And then the light that is in you becomes darkness. Tonight, God wants to save you. But it has to be on his terms. Because like Adam and Eve, you will want Christ to die in heaven so you could keep what you have now. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we come to you tonight. And we thank you. We know that there's hope because you would not have spoken to us this way if it was too late. Now, Father, I appeal to your children as you appeal to my mind. You said above all things you want us to prosper and be in health. Many of us didn't know the dangerous things that we've been putting into our bodies. And there's much more that we need to learn. Tonight, with our limited understanding, we want to give you our hearts. Tonight, we want to commit our lives to you. This is my prayer. Is that your prayer? Is that your desire tonight? Would you like to please Jesus? My son, give me your heart. That's what he says. Give me your heart. If we give him our hearts, he can save us. If we keep them, there's nothing he can do for us. Tonight, if you'd like to give Christ your heart, I'm going to invite you to just stand for special prayer. Father in heaven, what a mighty God we serve. A God who we can actually punish. And yet you will retaliate by loving us and desiring to save us. Tonight we accept salvation through Christ Jesus. We give you our hearts. And we ask again for the forgiveness of our sins. Now, Father, keep us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Would you be seated for a moment as the deacons come?